Welcome to Lifestyle Solopreneur, the community for entrepreneurs who put lifestyle first. Join your host, Flavia Barris, as she interviews successful lifestyle solopreneurs and shares ideas to help you find the perfect balance between lifestyle, business, and self. Flavia is an attorney, marketing expert, and founder of several online academies. She's been featured in major media, including BBC World News, The Wall Street Journal, The New York Post, ESPN Television, and more. Join us for this episode of Lifestyle Solopreneur.
Hey, Lifestyle Solopreneurs. Today, we are so excited to get to talk to Elaine Heaney. She grew her merch by Amazon business to six figures, selling just under $130,000 with a profit of $53,000 in her first 10 months. She is the CEO of Merch Entrepreneur and the host of her own podcast, the Merch Entrepreneur Podcast. Over the last 3 years, Elaine is also a triple number one bestselling author. She's an international keynote speaker. She's a movie producer and an Amazon FBA and merch consultant. So she helps other people with their own Amazon businesses. She has also published over 300 mobile apps across Amazon, Apple, and Google, and enjoyed over 20 million app downloads. Like, think about that figure. It's a lot of app downloads. She's got over 50 number ones worldwide. She's been featured in the Huffington Post, BBC, CNN, Entrepreneur.com, and Forbes. And we are so lucky to have you on, Elaine.
Hey, how are you? It's a pleasure to be on the show.
Hey, Elaine, it's super great to have you on the show today because you have a really inspiring story. It's great to have you. And I have to say a little something about your bio photo. You're absolutely the first guest to send in a headshot or bio photo of yourself out in nature petting a horse. I have to know more about this horse.
Oh my God. Yeah, the horse that you see in the picture is actually a horse called Cola. And that's a picture taken when I was on holidays over in Australia with a really good friend of mine, an amazing horseman called Steve Halfpenny. But yeah, it's funny, actually, horses are the reason I got into this whole crazy world of internet business and trying to make money online. I used to actually have like a proper job in an office about probably over 4.5 years now. And I was a project manager in an office in Dublin, in the capital of Ireland. And the issue was that I had this beautiful horse at home called Ozzy, who I adored, but home was like 3 hours away from where I would work. So it was crazy. I'd have to live in the city and work there and then maybe get home at weekends. But the issue was, for the work I was doing, I was a project manager. So in Ireland, the only jobs that I could actually find were in the city. So I could just see, if I was kind of looking at how my life was going to pan out, if I stayed where I was and stayed working as a project manager and maybe one day became a senior project manager, the problem would be I'd have to eventually like live like full time in Dublin or maybe buy a house or something. And then my whole, you know, passion for horses and horse riding was just going to completely disappear. And it's such a huge part of my life. I couldn't let that happen. So I decided to kind of make a calculated risk and try and actually, yeah, quit my job to see if I could actually make some kind of online business for myself. So that was about 4.5 years ago.
That's great. I mean, everyone's got their motivation. I mean, everyone's different, so everyone has their own story. But I think yours is probably pretty unique as a path to entrepreneurship, especially as a path to online entrepreneurship. I think most people in the horse world decide, you know, I'm going to be an entrepreneur, I'll be a trainer, I'll own a stable, I'll, you know, race horses or something. But you went in a different direction, although, you know, you'll fill us in. Maybe your Amazon business does have something to do with horses. I'm curious to learn more about it and how that all fits in. So how would you describe your way to earn income right now? Like, what is your job? Although none of my guests have a true J-O-B, but you all do something to make an income. What's yours?
So how I make an income these days is I create really simple designs, either on my computer or even on my iPhone. And then I upload them to a new program called Merch by Amazon. And when I upload these pictures, they go to Amazon, and then Amazon, these pictures get put on t-shirts and they get listed for sale on Amazon.com. And if people go and buy one of my t-shirts, I earn about $7 for each t-shirt I sell.
That is fantastic. Now, personally, I've been involved in cafe press, Zazzle, and some of these other print-on-demand merchandisers where you do upload your designs. In some cases, they even now are starting, you can upload your designs for fabric swatches and, you know, bandanas and, you know, not just the things that you normally think of, like t-shirts. And so you set up stores for different types of products. You put up your artwork. You don't have to have a single piece of inventory in your own garage or in your own warehouse. You don't have to have a single person putting on mailing labels. You just upload your design. And then these merchandisers like Cafe Press, like Zazzle, do all the work. But it sounds like Amazon has jumped in. How long has Merch by Amazon been on the radar, do you think?
Merch by Amazon started at the very end of September 2015. And I started doing Merch by Amazon in February 2016. But still, like, in the bigger scheme of things, if you were to talk to anybody, no one's actually heard of it, which is kind of crazy. So it's really new.
Well, that's great. And so for you, and that's another reason you probably have your podcast, because I'm guessing in your podcast, you dive really deep into how to become a very successful Merch by Amazon retailer. Is that right?
Absolutely. Yeah. No, I do share a lot of the tactics and the strategies that I've used. But really, the main reason I started the podcast was I just wanted to hear like the success stories of other people that were doing merch, because anything else I've tried before, like, you kind of have to be a bit technical or have some experience doing online stuff. But merch was kind of the first opportunity that I've come across that literally, like, anyone with with an internet connection can make a design on their phone and upload it. So I really wanted to, to kind of like connect with the community and just find stories of these successful merch entrepreneurs from all over the world and see why they were doing it and how it's changed their life.
Well, that's fantastic. And since I do have experience using Zazzle.com and CafePress.com for something similar, but probably without as much reach as the Amazon retail platform, I might experiment and maybe I will be successful. You can have me on your podcast, maybe this year even, or who knows, we'll see. But I'll definitely keep that on my radar because it sounds really exciting. So how did you hear about Merch by Amazon? Because it sounds like it's still not widely known as a new print-on-demand retailer on the scene. I hadn't heard of it until I heard about your fantastic success story. And of course, with this podcast and your podcast, people will slowly start learning more about it. By the time some listeners run across this podcast, if they don't hear it right away, if they're not subscribers, maybe it'll be a few months from now and even more people will have jumped in. So you're really an early adopter. And what was your tip to get in and to learn about this?
I found out about Merch by Amazon actually completely by accident. I didn't know anything about it. And I was doing at the time Amazon FBA. So that's fulfillment by Amazon. And kind of that model means that you go to Amazon.com or Amazon.co.uk. You're looking for physical products that are selling really well on one of those websites and maybe don't have a lot of competition, or you think you could do a, like, put a different spin on it or bundle things together. And then you actually go to Alibaba and you source physical products in China. You put them on a ship. It's a bit complicated. And then you get them over and you sell them on Amazon. So that's what I was doing. I was shipping in products from China and selling them on Amazon.com and Amazon Europe. And as part of doing that, like, I was in Facebook groups with people that were talking about this Amazon FBA. One other thing about the FBA business is that even though I live in Ireland, these products were shipped straight to the US and to the Amazon warehouse. So, you know, Amazon had tons of these fulfillment centers. So if I shipped in like 100 products, they would actually just stay in the fulfillment center. And if somebody bought one, Amazon would actually ship it out. So I didn't have to do like the postage and stuff myself. So that's what made it really good for me. But there was definitely headaches with that business as well in terms of like, oh, it's buying inventory and customer service and all this kind of thing. So I found out about Merch by Amazon by accident, actually just in an FBA Facebook group. Someone just wrote about it. They were like, oh yeah, Amazon's got this new program. You should have a look. So I clicked on it and immediately I was completely like gobsmacked pretty much, because I'd seen from Amazon FBA, I'd seen how much traffic there is on Amazon. Like, it's one of the most, you know, popular websites in the US.
Absolutely.
So I could see, yeah, I could see how much traffic was there. And you just, whatever you're making, you want to get your products on Amazon. But then I could see that combined with that, with this merch program, which was free to do, that basically I could just upload pictures from my computer for free. And these pictures could be put on different products. For now, it's just t-shirts. But I would get all of these different designs put in front of this massive like flow of traffic that's on Amazon. So for me, like with both of those, it was kind of like a no-brainer. I just, as soon as I saw it, I signed up immediately.
This is such a great story. I mean, it really is. And so that's how you ended up where you are now. You started off with fulfillment by Amazon FBA. And how did you end up in Amazon FBA? So we missed one link of your story. So how did you go from your sort of rat race job, corporate job, to that first leap to becoming an entrepreneur? Because that, I mean, sourcing products, importing them from foreign countries and having them fulfilled by Amazon, that's not an easy leap.
No, it's not at all. No, the reason I actually was able to kind of quit my job initially, it was actually, I had a friend called Stuart, and I blame him for all of this, because when I was in work, he was a programmer working in the same company as I was. And one day he walked over to my desk and he'd made this app. I didn't even know what an app was. I didn't have an iPhone or anything like this. And he showed me this little quiz app, like really, really basic. But he said he was making $200 a week from it. So I was kind of amazed. And like years ago, I'd read the Rich Dad, Poor Dad book. So I understood the power of making something once and selling it multiple times. So when I was still in work that Christmas, I went home, and on Christmas Eve, I started to Google how to make an app. Now, I'm not a programmer. I don't really have any tech skills. I definitely can't program an app, but I thought there must be some easy software that lets you make an app. So I did stop for a break for a Christmas dinner, but I pretty much worked solidly every day, published my first app on New Year's Eve, which was kind of amazing. So I kept working like just in my normal job after that, and work got a bit busy, but I did spend about 6 months working weekends and evenings, just like not a ton of time, but like a couple of hours every now and again. And in that first year, I got 30 apps published pretty much for free, just using this kind of free builder software that I found on the web that was really good. And that first year, while I still had like a proper job, I made $12,000. So that was kind of between that and just missing my horse so much, that gave me the spur to quit my job, got into apps full time. It was a lot of work, but it worked out pretty well. Sold that business. And then a friend of mine, I was at a conference with her, and this guy stood up on stage and he was like, okay, so you should probably think about selling physical goods on Amazon. And he said, it's really easy. You just do this research, find products that would be good to sell. You email a couple of people in China, they'll send it over on a boat, and you sell it and you make money. And I was like,
that sounds pretty easy.
Yeah, I was like, that just, no, you're selling me some kind of, I don't know what you're doing. Anyway, I didn't believe it, but my friend beside me, and I was really busy at the time, like I didn't have the headspace to try something random and new. But my friend that came as well, she actually followed it up, and she took whatever course it was he was selling, and she got into different communities. And this is all Amazon FBA, but I still had nothing to do with it. So I met up with her about 5 months later at another conference over in London. And she spent the whole 3 days telling me that I had to go and look at Amazon FBA, that it wasn't just rubbish and it does actually work, and there's tons of people making money with it. Right. So yeah, she convinced me, and then yeah, jumped into that.
So Stuart gets a nice bottle of wine, and then this friend, if you want to plug her name.
This is Nikki.
Nikki gets another bottle of wine. So they were very instrumental, I guess, in helping you on this path. What do you envision for the future? Where are you going with all of this?
I don't really know. I mean, my aim was to kind of, I guess, my goal was freedom, that I wanted to be able to work wherever I wanted. Like in Ireland, the weather is awful in the winter. And so actually right now I'm talking to you from Gran Canaria, which is a Spanish island off the coast of Africa. So the weather is pretty nice over here. But yeah, no, my goal was, it's not about the money. It's that I don't have to be locked up in an office in Dublin and not have time like for my family, not have time for my friends, not have time to travel or to do the things I really want to do. So that's a big part of it. And then I guess the other side of it is, and I didn't even know this when I started, but I don't know, I love the excitement of finding out, like learning new things and then trying to execute and see if they work. I don't know. It's not a game, but it's just something I really, really enjoy doing, like a puzzle. So I don't know if I'm describing it correctly.
Absolutely. You have the true heart of an entrepreneur. That's for sure. So other than this travel, so you're off the coast of Africa, obviously you're a traveler. And I guess you have that freedom now because your job isn't geographically tied anywhere, really. I mean, Amazon is worldwide and there's very little of what you're telling me you're doing that requires you to be anywhere in particular. So that's fantastic. What else do you do with your free time? What kind of hobbies do you like to do?
So my main hobby is horses. So I've actually booked in a couple of different horse courses. I'm actually going to Australia in a couple of weeks to go training over there. And yeah, I love as well. I go to kind of tech conferences. I guess that should be work and not a hobby. But honestly, I love going to them. I was just in one in Austin, Texas there in December. And I'm actually going to another one in Dallas in about 2 weeks time. So a bit of a long plane trip over. But now pretty much it's, yeah, just kind of keeping the business ticking along, doing as much horse stuff as I can. And yeah, just having time for myself, really.
I'll definitely have to introduce you to Aurora Cady. She's another software developer, women, you know, entrepreneurs in the software field. I think that was unfortunately a rarity in the past. Now, more and more, I think females are taking over that field. And she, Aurora, is just great. She's been a guest on the podcast. And she, like you, is very geographically independent now. And the reason I think of her is not just the software connection, but she was in Austin for a while too. So when you said Austin, I didn't think of that. For all I know, she was at the same tech conference. I know she's still there, you know, back and forth quite a bit. So, you know, what are some of your guilty pleasures? Those things that you consider very important, someone else might see as an indulgence. Let's not count the horse riding, because obviously that's not an indulgence. That's a necessity and the driving force to get you to where you are. But what are some of your other things that you've freed up your time enough that you can partake in and do?
I guess, well, I suppose the one that I kind of don't really tell people about is, you know, I guess being able to, during the winter, like go away and work somewhere warm. Like I've been in Spain now for about 5 weeks and literally I'm in like a co-working place here. So I think it's, I don't know. I mean, when you're kind of talking to people that have kind of normal jobs and, you know, it's really hard to kind of say, you know, and they're like, oh, what do you do? And you're like, oh yeah, I'm just going to Spain for winter, you know, to work. It sounds a bit kind of peculiar. So I don't know. I mean, for me, it makes complete sense. I mean, if you have the freedom, I think you should take advantage of it and not be kind of constrained. One of the other things I do actually that's really important to me is I've been really putting a lot more focus on my health. So every day I walk like 10,000 steps or 15,000 steps, which I think is something really important. So I've definitely cut down my work time from what I was doing before. And also things like just not sitting at the computer as much. So like my posture has improved. So I think that's all really, really important for me. Like you could say, well, you know, taking 3 hours off work in the middle of the day is a bit of a guilty pleasure. But for me, it's so good for me, for my health. And also then I kind of listen to podcasts as I'm walking around. So I listen to like an hour and a half of business podcasts every day. So I come back and I have so many new ideas and things I can implement. So that really works for me.
Oh, that's fantastic. I love the endless summer concept. I mean, I live in a surfer town and a lot of surfers live for that. You know, the endless summer, you just follow the seasons so that you're always surfing, it's always summer, and you never have really that down season. And I think they also call you, I guess you'd be a snowbird. A lot of people in the United States, they flee the snow and go to Florida or someplace, Las Vegas, wherever it might be, during the cold months. I think, you know, that's fantastic. And you must really, in order to, and your siesta time, you said if you take 3 hours off in the middle of the day, let me guess, you were in Spain. So it was like between 2 and 5 because everyone was closed up and sleeping or hanging out and chatting with friends. So nothing happens midday that way in Spain.
No, exactly. And then weather is the nicest. I'm not too sure in US degrees what it is, but it's like 20, 22 degrees here. So, I mean, you're really happy going around in like shorts and a t-shirt and stuff. So, yeah, so it's nice to get out when the sun is out and, yeah, get some exercise.
Oh, I'm a firm believer in all of that. And I have family in just north of Barcelona. So I just love Spain.
Oh, wow.
One of my absolute favorite destinations. And let's talk a little bit about productivity, efficiency, ways you can save time so you can reinvest that time in something fun, like what you're talking about, listening to podcasts, going on walks. I mean, one of your, I guess, efficiency tips that you've already given by accident is utilize time where you're otherwise exercising to do something like listening to business podcasts, because that's a really great way to have dual purpose during that time, or, you know, other things like that. Do you have software that you recommend or other tips?
Yes, yeah, so my two biggest tips. Number one, turn off the television. So I haven't watched television in God, I don't know how long. And it was just, when you look back on it, it's just a complete waste of time because they're only putting on programs to show you advertisements to make you buy stuff. So you're just being a consumer, whereas you want to turn the tables and you want to see yourself as a producer of content, not a consumer of content. So like I've got back probably 2 hours every day just from, you know, not watching television. One really good tool that I use in terms of productivity, I know there's different things. There's like Trello and Basecamp and Asana and all those. The one that I found that I actually couldn't live without, and it's completely free, it's a tool called Productive. So Productive. So it's like productive, but the end of it is TEEV. And it's just genius. Basically, you put in the tasks that have to be, like, it's really simple. So you put in the tasks that have to be done, you put in the name of the person who has to do them, and you put in the deadline, and that's it. And so my whole like business life is in Productive, and every day I can see exactly what I have to do. So I can search by person, like what they have to do, or I can search by what the task is. So for like my t-shirt business, I just click into the t-shirt thing and then I can see every day what I'm have to do for t-shirts. So that is amazing, because before that I had so many to-do lists and notepads and I'd forget where I'd have written something really important, and yeah, it was a nightmare.
That's a great one. I'll have to check it out. So when you say delegating to others, do you have a team? Do you outsource? Do you have employees? Do you have contractors? How do you structure your business? What do you recommend for people who themselves want to start a successful Merch by Amazon business?
Sure. So at the beginning, I think it's more important that you do everything yourself, because you got to learn and you got to test and you got to see what works and you got to go through the process. So I would say at the beginning, just start yourself, get up to speed and see how it goes. How I work is that because when I was doing like app development, because number one, I can't draw pictures, and number two, I can't program anything. Like I had to outsource straight away whether I wanted to or not. So I had a team of artists and developers and virtual assistants working for me. So they were all plugged into like Productive as well. So it worked really well. In terms of the team that I have now for the merch business, I have one virtual assistant who does a lot of the uploading for me. So if I make designs for merch, I can sell them as well on Teespring or Gearbubble or whatever the platforms I'm on. So I don't want to spend all day though uploading. So he helps me with a lot of the uploading, which is great.
That's great. So here's something I like to ask solopreneurs, because I think it helps other people who have their own resistance or a wall, or maybe they've had a bad experience and it scared them off of the whole entrepreneurship thing. So if you're willing to share a terrifying moment in your business and how that affected you, you know, what that moment was, how you got past it, I think it would be really helpful to all the listeners.
Sure. Well, I think, well, I've had three terrifying moments. So it's like one per business, and they all kind of happen at the beginning. So yeah, the first moment was like when I quit my job and I was going to try and do this app thing full time. And I was like, I was so scared. It was unreal. I was actually like in tears in work on the last day. And
oh,
you know,
no.
I knew I was like, sobbing in the bathroom. So bad. But I was like, I was excited because I knew it was going to be a new step, and like it was a sensible thing to do in the future, because it was actually riskier to stay in the job and to never try it. Whereas if I quit and tried it out and gave it 3 months and if it didn't work, like I get a job again. Do you know what I mean? So, mm-hmm. So I knew it was the sensible thing to do, but I was so terrified just of taking the step. Like I knew, I was just kind of emotional about it. I knew I'd get into it and it would either work or not work. And it was just like a moment I was having, but that, yeah, I kind of freaked out there for a little bit.
Right. When that's a common one too, I think.
Yeah.
That's a really common one. Just that paralysis that comes from fear of the unknown and fear of failure.
Yeah. Yeah. It's when you're in that time when you're trying to change something that's really like a really big part of your life that's taken up a lot of time, and you're going to change it to something else. Like it's completely normal to kind of get the heebie-jeebies and worry, because you don't really know what's going to happen in the future and you don't want to like make a mistake or anything. So yeah, no, I had a moment which wasn't good. And yeah, we were saying before about Amazon FBA sounding really difficult. Yeah, I was pretty terrified initially about that as well, because when I was doing the apps, the one kind of rule that I learned when I was like talking to developers around the world is that you need to stay away from Chinese developers, because they'll rip you off and they're just not good. And like, I'm sure there are good ones out there, but that was my experience from like working and firing a lot of Chinese developers. So when I heard with Amazon FBA that where you get all your stuff is China, like this seriously put me off, and I was really hesitant about the whole thing. And like Nikki did have to like completely twist my arm and tell me, you know, it will be fine. But that was, yeah, that was another kind of serious issue I had. But like anything, you just got to plow through it and get over it. And if it works, it works. If it doesn't, it doesn't. You know, you move on.
And what were some of your biggest mistakes that you can warn other entrepreneurs about? I mean, it may just be saying, don't let this terror of trying something new stop you. But if there's anything else that you like to, I'm sure you're a mentor to many, you know, in particular, once you start podcasting, lots of people contact you. In fact, listeners, contact me. That's why podcasters podcast. It's because we like community. We want to build communities. And I'm sure you're a mentor to many. What are some of the key tips that you give your mentees?
I think one of the biggest things when I'm talking to people who are kind of, they're looking like from a distance at what I'm doing, and they're like, oh, I don't know if I could do that. Or they just have like a belief about how they should, like, to make money, they have to have a proper job, and that's the only way you can do it. So I think one of the biggest mistakes is just not having an open mind to actually, well, you know, in this day and age, everybody's on Facebook, you've seen lots of Facebook ads, you know, there's obviously different models of business that are working. So if someone is telling you something, just not to completely shut it down, like what I did when I heard about Amazon FBA the first time, and it sounded too easy, and I was like, oh, that's stupid, I'm just gonna forget it. So I completely shut that down, I had a closed mind. So that was definitely a mistake that cost me like 6 months in my Amazon business. And yeah, that's something I've seen with other people. And over time, that can change. Like if someone's really hesitant now, maybe if they hear other people with similar stories or similar business models, you know, when they hear maybe three or four more stories in a couple of months, they'll kind of come around to it. But I think, yeah, just not having an open mind and maybe not having the headspace, because sometimes, like, well, not sometimes, like people are so busy these days, you know, with full-time jobs, families, maybe they're already working a side business. So sometimes even if something does present itself to you, that you literally don't have room in your head to go and actually figure it out to see if it's good or bad. So I think always having a little bit of headspace for, you know, just other opportunities and not just to be completely snowed under the whole time is really good too.
Fantastic advice, truly. So what are you working on now, and what can people do to build community with you? If they want to get in touch with you, if they want to see what you're doing out there, what's the best way to connect?
Absolutely. So I'm really excited about my podcast. I only launched it maybe two, three months ago. So that's the Merch Entrepreneur podcast. So yeah, if you're interested in learning more about selling t-shirts on Amazon, that's a really good place. You can hear stories from lots of people there. And then the website that goes with that is merchentrepreneur.com.
That's fantastic. So Merch Entrepreneur, that's M-E-R-C-H entrepreneur.com is where people can go to connect with you. Definitely subscribe to the Merch Entrepreneur podcast, my listeners, because I'm going to, and it sounds really great. And I'll tell you, I've been doing print on demand, both in book publishing as well as merchandising, for probably 3 years now, maybe even 4 years. And it's been a very great additional revenue stream of passive income, because just like Elaine shared, it can be a set it and forget it for the designs you've already uploaded or the books you've already written. And in particular, Amazon with book publishing, I've been firsthand witness to the power of Amazon as a search engine and their own built-in marketing, where you really, once you upload a book, you don't have to do a whole lot than just be listed in their directory to get sales on an ongoing basis. And I'm imagining that with t-shirt sales or print-on-demand products, it's going to be very similar. So I am so excited to hear that Amazon is doing this. I think it's great to be an early adopter of anything that's new and working and doing well. So for anyone listening to this podcast episode, use Elaine as your inspiration and check out Merch by Amazon. Check out her podcast so you can learn from the master directly. And again, Elaine, thank you so much for being on the show.
Not at all. It's a pleasure. And yeah, happy to help anyone that I can. And yeah, tons of info on the podcast. And I mean, with your background, you know, already having designs made for different platforms, you should definitely like jump in straight away.
Absolutely will. I'm just even just transferring over the already uploaded designs onto products on Amazon would be a just great way to parallel test and see how it does platform to platform. So Come on, everyone. Let's do it. Let's jump in. I think it's a good one. And I will definitely be checking you out at the Merch Entrepreneur Podcast. Thanks again for being on.
Thanks very much. It's been a pleasure.
Hey, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. And I hope you enjoyed the show. Don't forget to subscribe to this podcast. And if you leave a review on iTunes, I promise I will read every single review. If you know someone who makes a full-time living from part-time work, and maybe this is you, please visit lifestylesolopreneur.com to nominate a guest or to nominate yourself. Because remember this, money doesn't buy happiness, but money in the hands of a happy person, there is no greater tool.
Today's episode was brought to you by the Get Shift Done program. It's a lifestyle-changing online class to help you define your business and lifestyle ambitions and to set goals in a way you've never experienced before. This class will 10x your daily productivity with methods that will blow your mind. And if you use the coupon code PODCAST, the class tuition is 99% off. Visit GetShiftDone.com to enroll today.